The Center for Equity Studies recently released the sixth edition of its India Exclusion Report, or IXR, for the year 2019-2020. The report highlights the exclusion of sections from society, from the mainstream, and the denial of public goods to them on the basis of their class, caste, or ethnicity. This year, citizenship, childcare, employment, and public health form the four main parameters of exclusion. The report says that the creation of the NRC in Assam was a highly exclusionary exercise. Not just administrative inefficiencies, the exclusion was also brought about by what the IXR calls active hostility of the government towards Muslims of Bengali origin and Bengali Hindus. This was evident, for instance, in the NRC update process that permitted anyone to file an objection against the inclusion of any person in the draft NRC. The IXR has also found that children under the age of 6 years are a highly excluded category. They are left uncounted while framing public policies and allotting budgets. The result? Grave consequences for their health. Almost 90% of Indian children between the age of 6 months to 2 years do not receive the nutrition they require. Calling exclusion multidimensional, the report finds that a greater burden of exclusion has to be borne by children of marginalized groups. For instance, the poor, the informal workers, Dalits and Adivasis, single mothers, and children living in socially and economically challenging conditions. Another category of the excluded is that of workers. Within the formal sector, the report shows that there has been a decline in the numbers getting employed. Governments have been reluctant to fill these vacancies, the report has found. Instead, many permanent positions have either been replaced by contract appointments or the private sector has had to step in. At the same time, informal public workers like Anganwadi workers or ashas, mostly women, work without the status or benefits of regular government employees. This is despite them forming the majority in public employment. These workers have insecure contracts and deteriorating conditions of work, the IXR reports. Within this category of the excluded, the report notes that the category of migrant workers forms the underbelly. According to the report, most migrant workers come from historically oppressed and excluded social groups of scheduled castes and scheduled tribes, as well as religious minorities. These groups together stand at the bottom of India's labour market. Lastly, but significantly, the IXR found public health to be a key arena from which the poor and the marginalised were excluded. Increasing privatisation of healthcare, rising costs, absence of primary healthcare centres, all have led to the overburdening at select healthcare centres, thus excluding a large number of poor and marginalised Indians from quality and affordable healthcare. Harsh Mandar, director of the Centre for Equity Studies that released the India Exclusion Report, explains how the COVID-19 pandemic exacerbated these problems of public healthcare.
Indeed, devastating, and I would say very advisedly even genocidal was the decision of going in for the greatest, largest lockdown in human history in the planet, and its impact, which will last for generations, with the smallest relief. So that is one thing I talk about in my introduction. We invited a special chapter, Dr. T. Sundaraman, to talk about, again, the pandemic and its impact on the most vulnerable populations. So that's one thing significant in our report. Among the vulnerable populations that we have, there are many, but the four, but we got a chapter actually written about sex workers as workers. And the interesting thing is that it is built on a study on the lives and perspectives of sex workers by 600 sex workers themselves. And that, I think, is very special. We also have a chapter by Christoph Jaffrelot and Sharik Laliwala and others about Juhapara in Ahmedabad as a Muslim ghetto and life in a Muslim ghetto. There's a great deal else. It's hard to choose. We talked about circular migrants. We also talked about power loom workers in Surat. And once again, once we saw what happened after the lockdown, Surat is a city which is really interesting. It has 57% of its population is actually migrants who work on power looms, who work in, other diamond and other industries. And many of them come from very faraway places like Ganjam in Orissa, and they live and sleep in large crowded dormitories in very, very hard conditions. And so we updated that report with what happened to them after the lockdown. And that's a very important chapter as well. Jyoti Ghosh wrote a very interesting chapter on how employment in government is a public good, because we are taught more and more that small government is the best and we should have less and less employees. And what she argues is that India has a very low public employment, and without employing public servants, how are you going to be able to provide public health, as we see now, ICDS services, education, a whole range of public services depend on large employment in the public sector. And she argues for that as being a public good. And one last chapter that I among many that I'd like to draw your attention to is written by Prabhat Patnaik, who's an economist I admire most after Amartya Sen. And he makes a case of why we need to tax the super rich. And that, we often feel that we cannot provide universal social services like education, healthcare, and so on to pensions universally because we don't have the money. And he tries to demonstrate that we choose to not have the money. And even a small wealth tax, about 1% on the super rich, and an inheritance tax of 33% would be more than enough to provide basic universal social rights to all people in this country.
While the report seeks to influence policy making, Mandar says more important is for such reports to inform public opinion and action.
If we recall what Gandhiji had said, that when you are in doubt, think of the weakest, the most vulnerable person you know, and think of whether the policies that we are making, the decisions we are making, what it would do to their lives. And I really feel, for instance, the whole decision about the lockdown and a whole set of other decisions, if actually our policymakers would actually have thought about that most vulnerable person, they could not have gone in for a whole range of policies that have been devastating for the poor. So what we're trying to do also is, we believe, it is addressed to the state, but much more to the larger civil society, because, I've spent my life in government, in the NEC, as a human rights worker, struggling for finding ways that we can build a more just and caring state. But I realize now, at this age in my life, that a just and caring state can ultimately exist only in a just and caring society. And we have revealed ourselves, the Indian middle class and the rich have revealed ourselves over and over again, but I think most of all during this period of the lockdown and the pandemic, about being extremely uncaring about what happens to people of disadvantage, working people, minorities, Dalits, Adivasis, women. And it is this absence of care and active discrimination of the larger society of privilege that is reflected in the policies of the state. The problem is not out there, it is among us. And therefore, we feel that we need to have conversations through these reports. Whether the state really reads our reports and will listen to it is less our concern. Whether people in civil society, young people, students, thinking people, whether they learn, they become more compassionate, they become kinder, they believe more in the equal value of every life. And they analyze policies. Until they do that, the state is not going to change around. Arundhati Roy, in one of her conversations with us, said that COVID-19 is a virus, we know, but it is also an X-ray. It's an X-ray of society. And what we've revealed ourselves through this X-ray is of being, I argue, one of the most uncaring people in the world, in the Indian middle class and the rich. And I talk about how important solidarity is. Until we stand together, I may not be a Dalit, but I must stand with the Dalits. I may not be Muslim, but I will stand with the Muslims. I may not be a woman, but I'll stand with women, and so on and so forth. I may not be an informal worker, but I'll stand with them in solidarity. I think that is the biggest lesson that I hope that the larger society takes away. The anti-CA protests, many people ask, it was crushed. Did it accomplish? The law was not taken back. And now the farmers' protests that are underway. I think they're successes primarily because they demonstrate that we still have the capacity to stand together. That non-Muslims came out in very large numbers in protest, especially students, in protest against the CAA law, which discriminated against Indian Muslims. So they stood with their brothers and sisters at this time. And we had the largest non-violent movement that we have seen after independence, for Hindu-Muslim unity, in a sense. And the farmers' struggle we're seeing is following exactly this pattern. I mean, what is beautiful about it is people across religion, caste, class, are standing together as farmers and with the farmers. And I think that it is how we fight these battles that will determine the society we will build.